shared on Sunday morning. And I've, you know, been able to contemplate some things. And just thinking about basics, basic things, basic foundational things. And because I think sometimes we can get so spiritual we're no earthly good. You know, we're just, you know, we're just confident in our depth. I don't want to talk about basics, which is not depths as we understand it. I know over the years I've seen some different football teams just get real tricky and stuff. They learn all these trick plays and stuff like that. But they never could win the big ones because they weren't sticking to the basics, you know. And so I just wanted to share this morning and just kind of go back to some one main thing that I think is kind of basic. So let me do this. Can y'all see that?
Yes.
I figured you could. It's pretty big. I mean, my goodness, people. Turn with me, if you would, to Ephesians chapter 4. We're going to do a little bit in chapter 5 also, but let's start with chapter 4. And we're going to look at verse 29. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And let's skip verse 30 because I've shared on this before. Some of you may remember some time back I shared on forget the cross. Anybody remember that? And I went to forgiveness and some of the basic things. And the Holy Spirit just keeps telling me that if we don't get the basic things, it doesn't matter about all this other stuff. And this, you can't get more basic. You can't. There's no way you can go to salvation and get any more basic than He forgave you of your sins. And what basis that was on. And so let's look at verse 31. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And then verse 32, and be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. I believe that the verses that we've just been reading actually have to do with forgiveness. All of them before the ones right here on verse 32. That these are connected to forgiving one another. And that's his point. Shall I read it again in light of that? Okay. Verse 29. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good for the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. I believe that these things of corrupt communication, you know, not speaking things that are edifying, bitterness, wrath, anger, all of that, I believe that literally comes, at least in the context of this, can come in relationship to just not forgiving somebody. Y'all know what I'm saying? Just flat out not forgiving somebody. And, okay, so how would we put that in a context? Well, you can say, Well, let's use me as an example. Let's say that I haven't forgiven Joseph. Okay, we're going to do that. So good luck with this, buddy. Yeah. Okay. We're going to work on this. When I'm around him, I love him and I talk good, or I avoid him, but I still don't. But when I get around somebody else that I can, you know, talk to about him, then there's all this corrupt communication. There is not things that are edifying. Those don't come in. Does that make sense? Those don't come in to the equation. What comes out is bitterness and wrath and anger and evil speaking. And I kind of like the way verse 31 reads, because you can sort of read the end of it two different ways. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you, along with all malice. But the way I've read this over all these years is to put that away with malice. Go at it with something determined within you, you know what I mean? I don't know which way is correct. And as we've all noted, she's an idiot, he's an idiot, I'm an idiot, we don't know how to talk. But anyway, I don't know. But it works in me to put these things away with a force, a gumption within me to remove things that shouldn't be there if I've forgiven. And that's the point. That's the point. Forgive. In other words, you know, a big part of forgive is give, not take. No, I don't know. I mean, think about it now. What is most forgiveness to most people? It is somebody else comes and gives them something. I'm sorry, I shouldn't be such a jerk. You know, whatever. But this is forgive. This is you giving. And we're going to look at that when we get in chapter 5 a little more and see the true spirit behind this, because I believe that to truly gain the lamb. Now, all right, do I ever talk about the lamb around here? Okay. So for me to say to truly gain the lamb begins with forgiveness, I better put up or shut up today. Meaning I better show you from the scripture how incredibly important this is to gaining the nature of the lamb. To gaining the nature of the lamb. Okay, let's put it on this other front now. I know we all of us, and anybody who could listen to this ever, if this was preserved for 1,000 years, all of us have areas where someone has hurt us, or someone has, you know, spoken evil and you know, defiled your name and reputation by putting it all over the internet worldwide. Or they've just said some things to your friend or something. In other words, we have a basis of unforgiveness. At least we think we have a basis of unforgiveness. But the lamb is our basis to not have unforgiveness. Again, we'll explain this a little more as it goes, because it's pretty clear to me if you understand what it's saying here. And so, you know, I mean, I'll tell you right out, over the years, it's been about 20 now, sure has. It's been about 20 years since forces have come against me. I had a hard time in the beginning. I had a real hard time with people. And I had a hard time knowing that anywhere I went and anybody I ever met, when I shook their hand and they said, well, what's your name, da-da-da-da, what church you part of, they look it up on the internet and da-da-da-da, you know, it looks bad. But because I was having a hard time, I knew, and this is the only way I know how to put it, because I knew that that wasn't the lamb, and I knew that if I couldn't get over that, then anything else I called the lamb was not real nature, because we talk about the nature, right? Nature. And I knew that was, and especially being in the ministry, amen? Especially being in the ministry, I've said from the, probably before I even graduated Bible school, unforgiveness is not a luxury that I can afford. You know what I mean? It's not a luxury that I can afford. Because we can make it a luxury, you know? It can be an evil little demon inside of us, and we'll make a palace for it and go, oh, it's a luxury to have this, you know, thing inside of me or whatever. And I'm not attributing unforgiveness to demons alone. Certainly, probably in most cases, no. It is in relationship. Here's what we'd say. It's in relationship to what they did. Or I would say today, it's in relationship to what we have not allowed the Lamb to do in us in terms of nature on a beginning basic basis. Okay, so everybody with me on that now? Because that's important. That's the deal. On a beginning basic thing. So let me see if I can just spell this out. because, you know, this is the day Jesus rose from the dead. Not, we don't know when that was. And he never said celebrate that in that sense. Why? Because we're supposed to be celebrating his resurrection in his body every day. Amen? Okay. So, we were all sinners. As I look over this great congregation, I realize that we were all sinners. We all sinned and fell short of the glory of God. And we all, Lord willing, met Jesus. And when we met Jesus, he saved us, but he did it through the avenue of forgiving our sins. Is this correct or not? I mean, this is basic, basic, basic. Okay? So he forgave us. That was it. That was our entrance. That was the beginning of everything. When we stepped on that and believed it and received it, that opened a whole new avenue of reality for each and every one of us. Okay, so then, okay, if you do it based on a universal Christian viewpoint, we would say he forgave us because God was a good God. But folks, he didn't save us because God was a good God. He saved us because Jesus died for the sins that we should have died for. Well, God was in a good mood. Thank God that at that time, God got in a good mood after thousands of years of really just being hacked off in the Old Testament. That's some people's view or something. No, this is all based on giving, self-giving. You can't have forgiving without self-giving. And again, we'll see that in chapter 5. But to understand that the first step in is to look at a lamb, whether we understood he was a lamb or not, or even if we thought he was just a man, Jesus, who died for us and it counted, that was a lamb on the cross. And that lamb didn't just do that to forgive us, but did that so that we could see the way of God. Okay, so what are we describing as the way of God at this stage? We're describing as the way of God is to give, to forgive. That's his way. That's the way, and that's the door that he opened to all of us. And then we began to realize, I am forgiven based on that. And that forgiveness changed my life, right? Anybody, It's a big deal to me. You know, some of y'all were just born sweet. But there's a few of us that weren't. And that it was a big deal. It was a big, big deal. And my whole life changed. Okay? And so if I had have been, and I wasn't, but if I had have been raised in a nominal church that just taught forgiveness really more or less on terms of, well, okay, I'm going to be a good person and forgive you, then it would have perverted, it would have muddied the water of the foundation that I'm supposed to come in. And then I'd say, well, they haven't asked for forgiveness or whatever. You know, Jesus is hanging on the cross and he goes, hurry up, guys, I'm about to die. You need to apologize and ask me for forgiveness. Right? This is my last breath. Ask! No, he's hanging there, Father, forgive them. All right. Now, I'm not going to go into this aspect, but I dare you to check it out. There are scriptures in the New Testament, particularly Jesus says them in the Gospels, that relates to if your brother offends you and you repent, da 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 da, and you go through that whole message. I just am going to challenge you to check not just forgiveness out, but anything Jesus says in the Gospels, and find out that after his death, that he during his ministry, he didn't reveal all of the fullness of these things. And that after his death, God used Paul and the others to come along and really develop it. Ephesians 5, first couple of verses are going to really develop this for us as we look at it momentarily. To really develop that this all isn't just the same basis as it was in the Old Covenant. This is on a basis of the true fulfillment of sacrifice, and I'm going to say it right here, we're wrong if we think that sacrifice is only a sin offering. We're wrong. We don't understand forgiveness then. Because it's not. And we will, again, we'll get to that. But it's not. And so, well, if you're a sinner, you have to bring a lamb and he has to die and all this kind of stuff. But there, that can't show you Jesus' nature in that old covenant doing. It can reflect certain realities, but it cannot show you him and the way that he is. The cross shows you the way he is. The cross is the meaning. The cross is the great, if you want to use an example, the cross is the great example. But it's more than an example. There we see who we are if we're one with him. I ask you, come into my heart, make me one with you. Amen. Abi Gabi, nos goda magoda. Whatever you thought of at the moment of all of that kind of stuff, the point was he made you one and you were forever with him as one. Regardless of how bad you act or whatever you do. Is that true or not true? You are. You're still one. See, people say, well, I don't want to fall from grace. Okay, me neither. But the only way to fall from grace isn't through sin. You can't fall from grace by sinning too much. Okay, but think about it. Think about the concept of that. If it's grace, then you can't sin so much that grace is no longer there. It's only if there's a certain level of sinning that he withdraws his grace, but that's not falling from grace. Falling from grace is just not accepting grace. It's just that simple. You just don't accept grace. But grace is not, grace is not anything in itself. Grace is not anything in itself. It is an explanation of things. It's an explanation of, number one, that there's a cross and that someone died. It's an explanation of, this is, I'll just say the Father, but we can say the way God is, that he chose to send his son, that the son, so we'd have all three of them here, that the son, and we'll see that word usage here, that he gave up himself. He gave up himself. That's wrapped up in forgiveness. He gave up himself that we might be forgiven. Say, well, if you don't give up yourself, then they're not forgiven. Come on, I really need you to think this through as I say it, because I don't want to explain all of the little parts. I'm asking the Holy Spirit to like run with little veins through the whole thing. There's so much reality in this, and yet it's basic. It is basic to everything. Again, it's the door. We step through this door. We step through forgiveness. We step through the most basic way of knowing the Lamb and being able to live the Lamb. Because we can forgive after that. So if you first got saved and he says, forgive even as I have forgiven you, you'll go, your spirit, your heart is different in that. Because you go, I just got forgiven. My whole life, my whole sins, everything is forgiven. I'm ready to forgive you. You know, somebody does something horrible to you and you go, Jesus loves you. I forgive you. If he forgave me, who am I to hold this against you? Anybody remember that? I mean, long time ago. But still recall that those ways and stuff like that. And I know I was that way. It was like, I don't want to condemn anybody. My God, if anybody needed to be unforgiven, anybody needed to be condemned, it was me. And then I got religious. And what does that mean? Well, I got righteous. You know, I became something worthy of someone repenting to me. And I, you know, say, why are you preaching this, Randy? Because I need it. I don't want to be that. I don't want to be that person. I don't want that kind of a spirit and way in me that thinks I'm something that somebody ought to repent to me. I ought to forgive for Christ's sake and by Christ as the Lamb, not just, is this kind of making some clarity here? All right. So I saw all these scriptures here, all related to unforgiveness or not forgiving. And that's why not to everybody, verse 29, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good for the use of edifying, that it may minister grace to the hearers. Okay. When I saw this in relationship to forgiveness, I kind of saw three people. There's me. I don't need to let corrupt communication come out of my heart. There's the person that I'm talking to that I ought to minister grace to them. You see that? The person you're talking to about this person over there, I ought to be ministering grace to them. Do I need to get a couple of people up here to show the process? You know, that there's me with corrupt communication. There's the person I'm talking to about this other person over here that I haven't forgiven. But instead of ministering edification to that person, I'm ministering corrupt communication. You know? Well, I'm not only not edifying them, but who knows what I'm doing? You know, who knows what I'm doing to them? And, you know, I don't want to do that. And it's not Randy that doesn't want to do that. I believe that's the Spirit of God in me. You know, because before I got saved and forgiven, I would do stuff like that regularly. It was slimy, but that's what people do. They manipulate and they talk and they do all this kind of stuff. And I, you know, and any of that junk, here's my point for me. I don't want to this is just personally, I don't want to proceed any further in the land if I can't win the lamb in this area, if I can't gain the lamb in this area. Because after the Holy Spirit has dealt with me, I see that nothing, you can't walk past the cross and claim the lamb if you can't grasp the first step into it. And I'm saying you, but I can't. See, that's my point. I can't do that. That this is vital. This is the basics. That to do beyond that is to have trick plays trying to win the game. Sorry for the football terms for those who don't understand that. Instead of the basics, and I want the base, I want a foundation that is sure, and the foundation is the basics, you know? And to have that working in me by life that just comes up, you know, you don't have to worry about, I don't have to worry about corrupt communication, you know? I know edifying is going to come out because we all, you know, Shay said it this morning. I mean, we all need Jesus, and we all, you know, the last Sunday, I guess it was, I mean, it was a service, and it was praying for one another, and it was covering one another, and, you know, I mean, have you ever prayed for somebody that you haven't forgiven? I mean, I have. You know, I mean, I wish that instead of there being a will to hide or to pray or to do all this stuff, I wish nature just was nature within all of us. So that when we got ready to pray for somebody, we go, ch-ch-ch-ch. Excuse me, oh Lord. You know, we go, dang, I need Jesus. I don't really wish that because I'd be beat to a pulp by now. But anyway. Minister grace to the hearer, edifying them and ministering grace to the hearer. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger. See, all that bitterness and wrath and anger, I remember one time being angry at somebody, and I thought, I just wanted to just yell at them. Look, if you would just tell me you're sorry, if you would just, come on, how hard can it be to just say, I'm sorry, okay. Thank God, I forgive you. But the Lord would never, you know, and then I remember one person I was like that, and when finally the day that something happened between us, I found out they had no clue of what they'd done. And my whole time was like, what is wrong with you? I just say it, say. And if I'd have done that, they'd have gone, for what? Or whatever, you know. And of course, I would have gone, you know, you liar. Pits of hell are yours. It's really not quite that bad inside of me, but nonetheless. But there, you know, there comes this anger, this angst, this bitterness, this clamor. I mean, of the first three words, let all bitterness, wrath, and anger. Wrath and anger. Wrath and anger. Wrath and anger. And see, it's not even saying to the person who did the thing, forgive. It's saying to the person who's waiting for forgiveness to forgive back. Because, as we'll see here, give is the heart and soul of forgiveness. Give. And if give is the heart and soul of forgiveness, then the lamb is the heart and soul of give. Has to be. And if the lamb is the heart and soul of forgiveness, then that's the basic thing that was offered me when I got saved, forgiveness from the Lamb. I'm trying to trace it back to its origin and to see that. That's the basis of forgiveness and nothing else. Does that make sense? That's the basis of forgiveness and nothing else. We've made everything else the basis of forgiveness. And he's made it one thing, his Lamb nature and his willingness to give up himself. Because that's part of the giving, is that you give up yourself. You give up self. Well, self says, now you tell me if this isn't true, where there's unforgiveness, self says, well, I have a right to, you know, be angry. Anybody ever use that phrase? Well, I've got a right to be angry. And what is that? Well, they, you know, that was clamor in there, I think. Well, let me read this in the, this is the House of Lost Souls book. See how this reads. Let no foul or polluting language, nor evil word, nor unwholesome or worthless talk ever come out of your mouth, ever. But only such speech as is good and beneficial to the spiritual progress of others. As is fitting to the need and to the occasion, that it may be a blessing and give grace, God's favor, to those who hear it. Let all bitterness and indignation and wrath, all passion and rage and bad temper and resentment, anger and animosity and quarreling, contention and slander, evil speaking and abusive language, be banished from you with all malice. Become useful and helpful and kind to one another. Become useful. Well, you know what, golly. I mean, we're all useful to certain people, right? I mean, it's like we choose who we want to be particularly useful to. But we're all useful, but this is saying to these people. And this kind of stuff going on. And kind to one another, tenderhearted, and compassionate, understanding, forgiving one another readily and freely as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God. What is that saying? That's talking about forgiveness. This is how you imitate God. Therefore, be imitators of God. Copy him and follow his example as well-beloved children as they imitate their father. And walk in love, esteeming and delighting in one another as Christ loved us and gave up himself for us, a slain offering and sacrifice to God for you, so that it may become a sweet fragrance. All right, so I guess this isn't really the House of the Lost Souls. This is the Amplified Bible. But in chapter 5, verse 1, be ye therefore followers, or that translation said imitators of God, and I looked it up and it that's also a word that can be used there, as dear children. So it's not saying, in fact, when I read how it said this, I said, don't imitate God. Okay, so you have to see my weird mind. This can't be right. Why would I say such a stupid, crazy thing? When it says, be imitators of God, and then Randy says, don't imitate God. Don't imitate him. Don't just see God and imitate him. Do it as dear children who are of his seed and of his constitution. And have that kind of a being within your being, you know. It's not just Christian, imitate God. No, sir. No, this is family spirit. No, forgiveness is family spirit. Yes, Carolyn?
Yeah, you basically said, you know, imitator, you think of kind of carbon copies. It's an action, but the other is the seed from within. It's the nature that comes out versus just doing because they're doing it, so you're doing it.
Right.
Versus it being heart. The heart and the seed coming forth.
Right.
In that.
Amen. Yeah, I mean, if you really take that word imitator, it would say, there's someone that I would like to be like.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, see, the cool thing about this is there were no chapters when this was written. This was just a letter. You do realize that, right? And be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake forgave you, be ye imitators of God. There it is. There it is. He's saying that's the door right there. That's the first step in lambhood, if you will. Lambship, whatever word you want to use.
Lamminess.
That's the first step in being laminated. Sealed up in the Lamb. But I mean, it's amazing because, I'm sure y'all don't do this, but a lot of times when I get to a new chapter, I kind of forget everything that went before. And I'm going to go, well, I'm going to get this chapter now. See, and then it's like, it was a letter and this was the very sentence in front of that. And then it's stating here, look, forgive as God forgave you. Be ye followers, follow God in this way. In this way. Wow. That's just great. I mean, it's just great. And then he says in verse 2, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. All right, well, let's not go too fast here. So do it as God did. How did he do it? Well, he did it unconditionally. Okay, forgive unconditionally. Okay, let me say it a little different because we all know unconditionally. Unconditionally, yeah. How about all embracing? Forgive, all embracing. I wrote down a little thing about 2 years ago that I put in one of my journals. I said, forgive everyone everything. Just forgive everybody everything. You know, just, you know, why be picky? Oh, I'll forgive you, but I won't forgive you. Or you see what I'm saying? You know, there's partiality in that. And the scriptures say not with partiality. There's partiality in that. Another word that has become huge to me since I haven't been around y'all very much, I have replaced, when it's convenient, the word self-giving with self-forgetting. Self-forgetting. To do something in the process of forgetting yourself while you're doing it. Forgiveness is a good example of this, isn't it? Yeah, forgiveness is a good example of this. As long as I'm remembering self, you know, I can't be self-giving in the truest sense because I haven't forgotten self. Self is always in the equation. There's no way around it. It's as simple as that. It's simple math. You know, 1 + 1 + 1 more equals wrong. Self-forgetting. That if every time we thought in terms of, well, I need to be self-giving, you would include, I need to be self-forgetting. I need to forget self in this thing. I need not to remember me. What, either my feelings because I got hurt or what this will lead to that will benefit me eventually. You know. Now, let's just go back to the basics again. If we're crucified with Christ, then self-forgetting should be easy because we're dead. I mean, am I right or wrong, people? So what's the point of moving on beyond forgiveness or forgiving if we haven't settled those things? Anything that we teach, it's lost the effect that it could have because self is still in there. And it only produces after its kind. Trying to catch every eye there for a minute. You, yeah. No.
God's dealt with me a lot about this forgiveness, but you're saying, you say these words to somebody else about somebody else. What you're doing to them is putting bitterness and unforgiveness in them towards this other person, or even towards you, you know, whichever way you look at it. And so somebody had told me one time, it says, God gives the person hurt grace to be able to forgive. Whereas if I take that it was not a hurt given to me, but I will take that and give unforgiveness, I've had that grace to really, I do it in a way if I come to him. It's harder for me to forgive that other person than because I was taking it. So in doing that, I'm really hurting that hero.
Right. Right.
Maybe even worse than you were hurt.
Right.
And
I agree.
And so
you are imparting something.
Right. That wasn't even towards them, and they didn't yell.
Come here. Forgiveness, then, you're not just forgiving, you're losing your life in being forgiving. You are, you have to. That's the door, that's the Lamb, that's where it all came from. It's all one spirit. That's the new covenant. Not just, well, if they ask for forgiveness and you forgive them, you know, 70 times 7. I got news for you. There's something greater than 70 times 7. It's the ongoing selfless giving of the Lamb who gave himself on the cross. It's eternal. That's eternal. And that's why Paul deals with those kind of things. How much time have I got left? Okay, yes.
You're not releasing that spirit of the Lamb. If you're, please forgive me and things you're trying to get back. I mean, it's not really forgiveness if it's not selfless giving by that nature. It's almost a business agreement or, right. You know, I don't know. It isn't that.
Well, this verse 2 really says it. It says, walk in love as Christ hath loved us and hath given himself, and here is the original Greek, hath given himself up for us. Do it the way Christ loves. How? He gave up himself. Again, for unforgiveness is a huge violation of the Lamb and of the cross. And when I say violation, I mean contrary to the basic first step that he gave you and me to understand the Lamb and Christ crucified and all of the teaching that we teach. So imagine if I'm talking to myself more than I'm talking to you. What does that say? That says, nothing I have taught is worth anything if it is not being carried in the same Lamb spirit that forgiveness is. Or I'm just running past, I'm entering in some other way. Is that, you know what I'm saying? Because I think that can be applicable here. All right, so the last part of verse 2 says, hath given himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice. So forgiveness, folks, involves an offering and a sacrifice. Isn't that good? The word offering here is the word meal offering. And the word sacrifice is the word peace offering, both which are not sin offerings. They are sweet smelling savor, which is what comes very next. It's the very next word. Offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. We have made forgiveness nothing short of just only a sin offering. And we have viewed it in our ways of getting or giving forgiveness in light of a sin offering. And we've kept it within that realm so much that it's kept us from stepping on the first stone of lambship. I mean, we think we're stepping on it, but I'm talking about the lamb nature. I'm not just talking about the work of the cross. The lamb nature created the cross. Can I get amen on that? Or at least, because it'd just be another piece of wood without the lamb on it. You know? So we're talking now, we're not just talking about a sin offering and, you know, you bring your sin offering here and you kill it and da 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 because you did wrong. We're talking about a sweet savor offering, which is completely different, has nothing to do with sin, is basically a manner in which we please God. And the only way we can please God is through Christ, and that's him working through us in forgiveness, so that becomes a sweet-smelling savor if we do it in a spirit of offering and sacrifice. Did I say too much too fast? Would you like for me to repeat it? I can't. I don't know what I said just exactly right just there. It'd be good if you didn't catch it to get the tape and go back and listen to that part, because it is the explanation of why there was a meal offering. Okay, so what is a meal offering? It's a bloodless offering. A meal offering is a bloodless offering. Okay. Folks, there is a way to live Christ and to give Christ that doesn't require death. It's just him still. Now, you can't leave out the other offerings. You know what I mean? But it's bloodless. Well, you know, if it doesn't kill me, I don't know if I want to do it. You know, because it couldn't be the cross or something dumb. You know, no, there were bloodless sacrifices. And it's just the release of the lamb. Just you releasing the lamb. It doesn't have to be a sin offering. It doesn't have to be a slaughtered beast. Yes.
That, and you know, have a reaction or something like that, and a forgiveness moment comes, and where he's, the Holy Spirit's been leading me is that, you know, and it's, I'm still baby stepping through it, mm-hmm. And so where the Lord's had me is like turning, even though I'm having my reaction or whatever, but turning and lifting up the lamb heart within me, and I don't, it's like it's an exercise right now. It's not, you know, I have to choose it, but it's like, I'm just going, you know what? There's that altar that I've seen in me, and I know it's there, and I know it's him, and he's there all the time and always available. And so I just go, Lord, I'm just lifting up that heart and looking at it and saying, you're the one, you're the, you know, and I don't know how to put it into words, because it's that internal process, you know, that's by faith.
Yes.
But what happens is the reaction is nullified,
right?
And forgiveness flows, mm-hmm. and if that's what you want to call it. But it's just, you know, it's like, to me, it's not, oh, okay, now forgiveness has been activated. It's like, no, all my reactions are nullified, and then it's the Lord. Do
right.
you know what I mean?
Right.
And so to me, it's like that's, I don't know if I even label it, it turns into a thing instead of just being the Lord. But I know that's what it is. I don't know, does that...
Well, it's just the release. It's the release of Christ's nature.
Right.
And see, I mean...
I realize it's not my heart that's doing the forgiving. I'm just going,
right.
Your heart. You know,
right.
I'm kind of just like holding it up. Like, I remember Mallory teaching on wave offering at some point, I don't know how many years ago, and it was just... That has come back to me again and again, because I feel like I can just go, it's your heart. I'm going to wave your heart, you know, in front of you and just lift that up because it's you. And then it's just, it's just real in me all of a sudden.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Well, and you know, the peace offering is a bloody sacrifice. And I don't want to go into all these offerings and stuff. And we've had enough teaching from me and all of us along these lines. But I mean, for me, I mean, just what Jennifer was saying, for me, I don't want to teach on a wave, I mean, not a wave, I don't want to teach on a peace offering or a meal offering, meat offering. I don't want to teach on those if I haven't got forgiveness down. Because most of the ways that we teach it, that I've taught it for years, is way down the road out over here, leaving the basics. I mean, it's like, I just want to go back here. If I can do it at the door, then I'll be okay with teaching it. But in the meantime, I don't know that I want to say anything about it. And I don't know that I've understood it, but I don't understand it. When it, the first thing out of the cup, you remember the parable Jesus told? It was a king, and he said, da 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 da, and they go, oh, please give me, and he forgave him. And then that guy went out and he started condemning and saying, you pay me, you know, to somebody else. Y'all remember that one? You know, and the king didn't go, well, you know, he's just young. You know, he went, that's the basics. Well, you need to get this down on a core basis now in this area. If you can't get this now, so this is where what I was saying was coming from. I don't know that I want to teach you way down here if I can't live it at the door. I don't want to do it. I'm ashamed. I'm ashamed of doing it if I haven't captured it there. Because Jesus, the king in that parable, because Jesus expects us to get that forgiveness and go out and do it in these kind of offerings, not just a sin offering. You know, the priest going, you need to give a sin offering. You've sinned, da 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 da. The peace offering includes the priest, the person who sinned, and God. And they all sit down and eat the same sacrifice. It's one of the only ones where you get everybody together over a feast. It's like the Lord's Supper. This is what we're eating. But it's forgiveness in lamb form. Forgiveness in lamb form. And not on any other basis. It's the eternal one that has captured us. Even if all we can do is step away and see one person that owes us and can forgive them, the king is pleased. But we think, well, he doesn't notice what I, you know what I mean? I mean, how many do you believe of us have ever prayed and asked for forgiveness and then turned around and then still held? I mean, I think we all have. And the king's looking at that. I mean, he sees that stuff. He sees this, and he's not pleased. And he's not upset. He's not just upset, well, you mistreated somebody. He's upset that you do this as Christ. Therefore, be followers. Walk in love as Christ hath loved us and by giving up himself. And it wasn't Christ in you. It's not a sweet savor. And even if you say, anybody done this, and I know we all have, I forgive you, turn right around and have trouble with it later on. It rises back up and all this unforgiveness, you go, you know, where the, I thought, you know, I mean, I've really struggled with that at times, you know, where it's like, I know I forgave them. Where'd all this come from? You probably at the moment felt spiritual and felt really good. Maybe the Lord was moving in service, but there was no self-forgetting. No self-forgetting. And I know that the true form of self-forgetting is right here in the middle of give. There's no T in give. But I just made it. but it's not a T, it's a cross. And that's the heart and soul of it. But so anyway, let me just make sure. Well. Oh yeah. I said, you know, through these two offerings, it brings forth more than forgiveness. Through these sweet savor offerings, not the sin offering, through these sweet savor, it's bringing forth more than forgiveness. It's being a sweet savor to the Father of Christ. Amen. How high is that? You know, it's not just two people in time going, okay, I forgive you, you know. No, it's a sweet, it's rising. There's a resurrection. There's an ascension.
Amen.
There's an Easter Sunday. The real one. No forgiveness means no true offering. No forgiveness means no fragrance of Christ. Because there's no true offering because it's not the right offerings. An offering and a sacrifice to God. And then in here again, no one has to repent. Jesus, the Lamb, hung on the cross. And no one had to repent at that point. Because he forgave. That was from his heart. That was settled. And I know we all circle around and around and around on these things. There's no way that I can communicate, because I need it communicated to me more. So our minds will always circle around. We always can grab a scripture. We always can make an excuse to not be self-forgetting. But the Father never forgets this. He never forgets his son. And he wants his son. And it does make him angry. I'm sorry, but it does. According to that parable, Jesus told it. So come on. He ought to know. He knows the guy. All right, that's enough. I'm sick of the sound of my voice. Thank you all for all the comments. And I just ask you to, if nothing else, be in prayer for me, because my desire is to go back and find him in the purest, simplest forms. And if those can capture my heart, then I don't have to worry about everything else. But if I have the strength of my own self to run way ahead and then get into all of this stuff and share all this stuff, and none of it have that same basic spirit that was basic and foundational that he brought me through, then I feel, this is me, then I feel, I have failed. And I don't mean I failed God and I'm bound for hell, and, you know, because he forgives. Amen. Deb.
Yeah, I'm really for sharing. The Lord's been so sweet with us, opening his heart and sharing with us more of the nature of the Lamb. That I know myself, I don't know about others, but you can start to get this idealistic or view of what the Lamb is without reality, and with what the real core of who he is and what he's made of. And it's like putting the wrong building block in, you know, a square peg into a whole place. It doesn't fit, and you're not really proceeding on. So thank you for sharing. I don't understand it all, but I want to be open to Jesus. This is the Jesus that he is.
Amen. Anybody else have a comment? Yeah.
About forgiveness, something the Lord shared with me recently, and I hope it's not too deep because I don't mean it to be that way, but that the Father forgives us on the basis of what he's made us in his heart. And when I forgive somebody, I'm saying, you're who he is in his heart, and I'm going to let everything go. That's, because then it becomes more than just saying, oh, that's okay. Now, in forgiving, I'm fighting for that image to be in them.
Right.
It's more than just going, oh, that's okay, it's water to the bridge. I am saying I love the image in the Father's heart of bride, of that member being conformed. When they do something that's contrary to the image in God's heart, I'm standing with that true image. I'm letting the old be washed away in the faith that they're going to come in at some point. And for me personally, that has really helped, like, put it in perspective. Like, they had done this horrible thing to me, I can't forgive that. But to know that Jesus is already down the road in his heart, that he's over that.
Amen.
You know? And I can be over that and be down the road in that true vision of what he wants that person to be. You know? And I can live in that vision of them. And then I can let that thing just go. It's just decaying, not its chaff. You know, it'll come through away.
So. I think we all can... We all have things that we cling to that the Lord has given us in relationship to this. And it's not all the same things of what I've shared tonight. I don't, you're the pastor, so. No, I don't think necessarily everybody is supposed to be where I'm at, or that you're supposed to understand. It's like what Mallory said. There may be some of you going, well, I don't get that, or that doesn't work in me, or da 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 da. same with what I've shared. But I think just for what the Lord has been dealing with me, it's really tied to those two offerings. And it just tore me up to see it wasn't a sin offering that he was dealing with. It was, and it involved him just being self-forgetting. He gave up himself. Boom. Whoa. And of course, all offerings are giving up of himself. But I think that, you know, like some things Carolyn has shared and what Mallory shared, and, you know, there are other aspects of this thing that are important. I don't have the corner on all truth. You know, I don't even feel pressure to necessarily share what I get from. I get a lot. Let me tell you, I get a lot from the Lord. The Lord shares a lot with me. I'm only supposed to share what he asked me to share. And that may be once every 3 months or something like that, on a Sunday or something. But I know, I know that I felt his heart when I was in these verses. I know I felt his heart. I knew that there was something there that he wanted me to share of this. And it was something that we needed too. Whether it's based on the words that I shared or not, that's something that we needed too. And that somewhere along the line, not in all truth, but in this area, we need to go back to basics. And that this is important to him. But just because I say that is not meant to move your heart. That's up to you. But so that's why I even stood up here today to speak, because I felt his heart in this.
We will pray.
And also, just to, you know, I heard the Lord in what Jennifer shared. I heard the Lord in, you know, what Mallory shared and what Deb and Carolyn have shared. And I believe that there may be one of us here that needs something that they shared, and another one needs something this other person shared, another this and that. But more importantly, we need what the Holy Spirit wants to share. So is it okay if I just pray along those lines? Why don't we just stand together? And if you wouldn't mind, if you could just join hands across the center here, and we'll just all be together on this. This is turning into a circle. Welcome to Acts. Father, I think that we sense something that rings true here. We may not all be able to grasp it. I don't grasp it. But we're asking you to begin to reveal things in relationship to giving, forgiving. And we don't really want to just do it. We want it to come out of you, Jesus. We want it to come out of you as Lamb who gave yourself. We want it to be an extension of you. We want to do it as your children, as your family, as your seed, as those of the same family spirit as you, from your family, Father. And so all we know to do is to put it on those bases and say, proceed as you will in us. But Lord, that was a great sermon I preached years ago about, well, forget the cross. If we can, let's just learn to forgive and da 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 da. But Father, I don't know how much impact it really has had, because that's not the goal. The goal is for you to impact us in the way you want to, by your Spirit, when you want to. And so we all just bow our hearts and we just say, have your way in us. And if this really is something that was in your heart that you had me share today, then do what it is that you want to do to accomplish these things. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, you know I've also prayed over this word, self-forgetting. And I've asked you to make it powerful in our lives here, because I believe it's the most powerful word now above self-sacrificing or self, all the other words that we use, self-giving. I believe that if we can begin to let that seep into our being, it will revolutionize our approach. So you do that if that's what you want. Thank you. Thank you for the openness of this people that loves you, that seeks you, and that desires you, and that cries out to you. Thank you. Thank you so much for giving up yourself. And may we go away from here giving up ourselves. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, hug somebody you hate.